Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
The aftermath of every social revolution brings about change. Cultural norms and landmarks shift as our minds and hearts expand beyond the familiar. To everything, there is a season and a time to every purpose in the land of the living. This is our time to renew, revive, and restore the hope lost to the busyness of life. This is our time to dig again and rebuild from the storms of our past on a solid footing that holds. Welcome to The Foundation.
The Foundation.
The Foundation of Hearts Grants is brought to you by Alive, Burger King, Commonwealth Bank, the Deposit Insurance Corporation, Grand Bahama News, Marco's Pizza, the Ministry of Health and Wellness, Popeyes, Ross Electric Motors, and Wendy's.
Foundation. The Foundation.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. 96.9 FM radio, Howard Grant and your company, The Foundation, on this absolutely gorgeous Monday afternoon. I say that very clearly. As you know, I can't see. I'm not here. But I'm here. I'm excited, guys. It's a beautiful day. I'm truly grateful to be in the land of the living, always being able to go out here. I know you guys have been talking a great deal about what we did on Friday of last week in terms of the commemoration of being able to identify the life that was Obadiah Wolschcombe. He is, a great man in many, many instances. And it's sad to hear about these stories after persons pass away, but we're grateful for the life that was and continue to be able to learn from those examples to move in the direction that we were called to move in. I'm grateful. It's a beautiful day, guys. I just want to be as decent as possible. Make sure you pick up your Guardian newspaper. I cannot see the headlines, but I'm hoping that it's nothing horrendous. I know that we're getting deeper into political conversation. So as the week progresses, you're going to be able to see more and more of that. I got a couple of calls. Listen to me. We're going to have a very clear conversations about a few calls that I've gotten right after I did the show about a few prospects. El Diablo es un mentira. Eh? I just want to be very clear about this. It's a good day, guys. I want to do that. Pick up your papers, like I said. I want to give a shout out to my good, decent people over there at AFS Insurance, agents and brokers. Make sure you get that taken care of as we move over into the next spot of the month. We're mid-month now. And if you are still riding dirty, the devil is a liar. We can see you. God can see you. You need to stop. Get yourself prepared. Go down there and get your car insured. Take all those things and get yourself prepared to do that. From the time we were talking about this, you can got your car. You could have gotten your car insured maybe twice or three times. Ensure you go down there and talk to my good guy, Etheric Bow. He'd be more than happy to assist you in those areas. I want to give a shout out also to Bahamas Harvest Church. I'm with none other than Pastor Mario Moxie and his beautiful wife, Erica. They always continue to be able to do wonderful, wonderful things down there. I want to thank you guys so much for being able to support us with what we're doing here with the foundation. I'm really, really grateful for the opportunity. I want to thank also Bahamas Bus and Truck for being able to make that kind of commitment to us to make some things happen. Guys, I'm grateful for it. I know that we have some other commitments for some things to happen. Guys, we are here. If you want to be able to give me a call whilst we're here, I should be in the air. Right now, God spare our life as it relates to being able to go to China. But we're going to be able to do that. We're wide open for you. Give me a call, 827-0111, 827-0111. We're going to be able to chop this thing down. I am grateful. I had to do this in the can. I got a call a couple weeks back to talk about a prospect. I think the thing just popped up in my phone to talk about a prospect that had to merge the coexistence, rather, of faith and science. For far too long, I think we've had this kind of a conversation, very stoic and, it's confined in its thinking. It doesn't have that blossom, the ability to be able to expand beyond this preconformed state, this state that is just a box, right? And everything's stuffed in that box. And there's always this sort of an idea that science is on one side and that faith is on the other, and the two should never be able to meet. This is that proverbial gulf that exists between Lazarus and the poor man, the rich man, right? That proverbial gulf is the science and faith. But with quantum science and quantum physics and these kind of progressive concepts that continue to be able to bleed in, we're finding out with more and more research that some things are happening out there. Well, today, we're going to have this conversation. Today, we're going to be able to talk with none other than the Seventh-day Adventist Church. They celebrate something. They tell me Creation Weekend. They've been doing it for a few years now. And from October 26th to the 28th, they're going to be talking about Faith and Science Weekend, Evolution or Creation. And this is the South Bahamas Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. And I am extremely excited to kind of delve into this conversation today. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to introduce you to two persons who kind of reached out to me, and they, I don't know if they knew this, but they have piqued my interest in terms of trying to figure out or trying to push past the curtains into understanding something, because there is the tangibles and the intangibles. Is this a translucent conversation? We're going to get into it. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to introduce you to none other than Major Coleman. He is a JD, PhD, SDJ, and a law professor. He's going to be talking about today. And also, we have Sandra Philip Burrows here with us. Please introduce yourself to the listening audience out there.
Hey, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Sandra, and I'm so happy to be with Howard and Major today to talk about our Faith and Science Weekend that's coming up on October 26th to 28th. So thank you again for having me.
Absolutely. And Major, give me a little background on who you are. And I think we should just dive right into the thing. Tell me about where did this concept emerge from? Tell me about yourself and tell me where this concept emerged from.
Well, Howard, I've been a Christian all my life. And I love Jesus. All that thrills my soul is Jesus. But I didn't know very much about science. And I just assumed that the science did not support the Bible, that it supported evolution concepts. And I kind of just accepted that. It wasn't until my son was 5 years old and he was about to start school, and I knew that he would be learning about evolution, and I decided that I needed to begin to educate myself. So that's really how I got started.
Really? So you said you were Christian your entire life, right?
Yes,
I'm going to be decent with you. I do my best to be decent. You sound like you're in your mid-50s. Talk to me. I don't want to get deep in your business.
Well, thank you so much. I really appreciate that. But I would have been in my mid-50s several decades ago.
You need to stop it. This pitch is lying on you then, because you're looking extremely young on these things, man. But I want to talk to you like this.
So I feel like I'm 50.
You feel like you're 50. Okay, that's excellent. I think, as a man thinketh, talk to me, right? So,
there you go.
So tell me this, because this is the way that I evolve in my thinking, and I want to kind of break it down. So, your son was 5 years old. You said you've been a Christian your entire life. You live by faith.
Yeah.
You walk by faith. You ingested information, and you applied yourself in conviction to the word of God and moving in this particular direction, never being able to open yourself to any other possibilities. But as your son actually evolves and has to matriculate through the education system, I assume that you guys are out of the United States of America. Is that okay?
Yes, that's right. We're in the U.S. And he was getting ready to start kindergarten. And I knew that it wouldn't be long. He went to a top quality prep school. In fact, he went to the same school that Barack Obama's children went to, the University of Chicago Lab School.
Really? Really?
I was doing my PhD at that time at the University of Chicago, and I knew that he was going to be learning about science and evolution, and I knew that I had to be prepared. I hadn't had any training, but just from what I was hearing, I assumed that the science did not support the Bible, that it supported evolution, and I really wanted to know how bad it was. Mm-hmm. And so that's how I started, and I started going to seminars. And my first seminar, I heard on the radio that there was going to be a seminar, at Moody Bible Institute by Dr. Walter Brown, and I went to the seminar, and that's how I got started, and it changed my life.
This is an amazing thing. You know what's amazing about it is that our children, even though our interest may not necessarily be piqued, we've been living in this sort of a conditioned state for such a long time, just moving about to and fro, doing what we have and what we've been called to do. But our children give us pause to kind of look outside of that and say, hey, listen, I don't want them to step in this landmine. How do I now prevent that? And you have to learn about it. You have to learn about these things. I'd like to know what you found out. I'd like to know about some of the concepts and ideas that you came across that caused you to go deeper into the rabbit hole.
Well, I was very shocked. It was an all-day seminar. Dr. Walter Brown is still the leading creation scientist. He's pushing 90 now, so, you know, he's not as, you know, you have to slow down a little bit. But first, I learned that the science does not support evolution, that the science supports God's word. Now, that was a shock to me. Mm-hmm. And then I learned how Noah's flood actually started. That was an even bigger shock. And what it did, I always thought that the flood was caused by rain. I was shocked to find out that that is not what happened at all. Mm-hmm. And then the science in geology, in biology, in astrophysics, everywhere that I looked, I found that God's word could be validated and that the science supported the Bible. And I taught these things to my son, and he went a little overboard. He started challenging his teachers, and I told him, son, please don't do that.
But this is what sons do. This is what sons do.
I said, you don't have to do that. You can keep it to yourself. You know, but he refused to do that. He started challenging their evolutionary concepts. And none of them could gain sway over him. That is, they did not have answers. I found out that they did not know the science.
No.
And I started teaching after I got my PhD, and I started teaching. I started introducing, because I was a race specialist, mm-hmm. and I started introducing these concepts. Of course, evolution is inherently racist. Mm-hmm. So it really fit right into what I was teaching, and I taught on a university campuses in different parts of the United States. And everywhere I went, I took the Origins program with me, and I continued to learn and to grow.
Mm-hmm. I'm excited to be able to hear that. I love to hear these kind of stories. I want to be able to do this now. We're going to dive deeper into this. And when we get back, I want to take this quick commercial break. When we get back, I want to talk to you, Sandra, about this kind of a concept and idea that exists, that where this came from, how did we do this? For far too long, we've known the Seventh-day Adventist Church to be those persons who are committed to being able to worship on Saturday and commit themselves to a stringent regimen, a particular diet that continues to be able to lead them in a particular direction. So there is preconceived notions and conditions socially about a mindset that has to do with the Seventh-day Adventist, but this is very, very progressive. I'd like to talk to you about that. Let's take this quick commercial break, ladies and gentlemen, and be right back after this.
We've been with you from the very start, leading the way and providing you with the best in primetime sporting experiences. From one goal to the next, you can count on us for full access to the best sports channels at home or on the go. Make Rev your only choice. Visit Rev.bs. Every match, every game, every moment. Rev, your home for sports.
America completely run out of it.
Struggling to repay your loan? Let us help you get back on track with payment terms that suits your financial situation and improve your credit score and credit report with the Bahamas Credit Bureau. Inquire about our restructured loans today. Call us at 356-7764.
And we are back, ladies and gentlemen, 96.9 FM radio, Howard Grant in your company, the foundation on this absolutely gorgeous Monday afternoon, live and in full effect, October 16th. If you're celebrating your birthday, happy birthday to you guys. Enjoy yourself and continue to be able to give praise. You are in the land of the living. talking about the land of living, when we left off, we were having a conversation that actually merges or finds the intersection between faith, maybe not even the intersection, you know, maybe the inclusion of faith and science. You know, we're talking with none other than Major Coleman, a PhD law professor, being able to give us more information. And Sandra Burrows here from the Seventh-day Church being able to give us a very clear path as to exactly what's what and what's the church commitment as it relates to creation Sabbath this weekend that you guys are doing. I want to hear a little bit more about that, Sandra. Tell me about how many years you guys have been doing this over at the Seventh-day Church and the concept and idea associated with how this emerged. We know historically that Saturdays is a time, is a Sabbath for you. There's not much being done, that you guys are laid back and you just continue to be able to worship. You go to church on Saturdays and you give praise to the Almighty for this particular time. But you decided to do this. Talk to me about where this came from.
Okay, several years ago, this perhaps might have been about 10, 12 years ago, our church's headquarters, the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, they set aside the fourth Sabbath or Saturday in October every year as Creation Sabbath. It was intended and has been since then to celebrate creation, because creation, when we think about creation, as the Bible said, the first 6 days and the seventh day, God rested and he celebrated. Mm-hmm. And so celebrate creation on that day. So I'm a geographer by profession. And for many, many years now, I have been fascinated and really interested in what has been happening in the field of geology, particularly as Major, his interest was in the flood. I have really been fascinated by the flood and the events of the flood. And so I have been reading up a lot on it, studying it over the years. And so 5 years ago, the South Bahamas Conference of Seventh-day Adventists decided that they would engage in the full celebration of creation on that fourth Sabbath in October. And so this is where we are today. Over the years, we have had biologists, geologists. In fact, the first year, we had a dinosaur specialist come to us and made some very interesting presentations.
Really?
Last year, we had a chemist. Wow. This year, we have a law professor. And I know Major is going to be sharing a lot more with you about his passion for both creation as it relates to evolution and so on. So we celebrate creation as a church, as a world church, and we celebrate creation in the South Bahamas Conference, and we have been doing it for 5 years. Very excited.
I'm excited.
So we have a number of events planned out this weekend. Go ahead.
No, I'm saying I'm excited to hear about that. I want you to tell me some about the events that you guys have going on this weekend, the church is going to be doing this weekend.
So we kick off the events on October 26th at 6 p.m. We will be at the University of the Bahamas, the HCM Library Auditorium. Mm-hmm. And the first presentation, the topic, and I'm sure this is going to be an exciting topic. I am inviting all your listeners, as many as possible, to come out. It's going to be evolution or creation, which is true. And so the students are going to be showing up, and we are hoping as many others from the community will as well. On the Saturday, we are
You're
having
going to be doing this at the events. University of the Bahamas, correct?
Yes, the University of the Bahamas,
okay.
The auditorium in the library at 6 p.m.
Okay.
And
okay.
So it's open to all.
Okay.
And then on the Saturday, the 28th, we have four events, 8 o'clock in the morning at the Grandstown Seventh-day Adventist Church. Major will be presenting on the topic, At Dawn We Slept, and I'm sure he'll share more about that. Then at the Hillview Seventh-day Adventist Church, which is on Tonic Williams Darling Highway, at 9:45, he will be making a presentation, Real Faith versus Blind Faith. And I'm glad you made that introduction earlier on, where you said that we tend to put faith in one box and we have science in another box, and the two should never meet. But in fact, you know, they do come together. And then at 11 o'clock, also at Hillview, the topic will be When the Impossible Has Been Eliminated. And then we come back at 4:30 with a very exciting topic, God Invented Science. And so I'm inviting as many of you, all our listeners, to come out and enjoy the celebration of God's creation at those events.
Well, thank you so very kindly, Sandra. I really do. Well, I'm hoping that you have an opportunity to either be able to see it or zoom in, because I'm intrigued. I really am. And like I said, I'm not here in the country right now. We have gone on a journey to be able to find out some stuff of what's happening out in the world. I'm going to be doing my show live this week all the way from China. And so I'm excited about being able to do that. But I had to capture this conversation with you because I need to know a little more. Because I'm inquisitive. I mean, my five-year-old mind, like Major's son, is asking more and more questions about how do we do this? How do we now, are we not muddying and murking the waters of our religion? Not faith now, watch me. Religion, because in this dispensation and time, this era that we live in, a lot of persons find themselves trying to detach from the church, trying to detach from the formality, the religion or the rhythm of religion, and being able to find a deeper relationship. Major, I want to ask you that question. Talk to me about what in your exploits, your exploration, and being able to find out deeper just to be able to inform, enlighten, encourage, and prepare your son to step out into the world. What did you find out about yourself and the midst of this pursuit that you want to be able to share with us? Talk to me about it.
Well, I learned that we cannot make assumptions. You see, I didn't know anything about the science, either from an evolutionary standpoint or a creation standpoint. Mm-hmm. The only thing I knew was the things that were being said around me, and I assumed they were correct. Mm-hmm. Many people will lose their souls because they assume things and they never investigated. In Jesus' day, many people had lots of assumptions about him. They never read the Bible. They never read the scriptures. As Jesus told them to search the scriptures. Look, read, study, compare. All right. And so I never did these things. So when it came time for my son to go to school, I started off flat-footed. Fortunately, there were people around who were studying the science, who knew and understood these things, and they were aggressive. They were reaching out. They were having programs. They were inviting people to come. So once I started attending these programs and I began to learn, I realized the danger of making assumptions without studying, without really comparing the science and looking into it. And that's when I began to learn. And of course, it changed my life. It made me very aggressive so that now I have my own programs and I'm educating people in the same way that I was educated.
It's an amazing thing that you're doing that, because now even that pursuit in education all the way in America has now landed on our shores and is edifying us, because I need to know more. I'd like to know about this concept. Let's talk about foundationally. Are we talking about quantum physics? Are we talking about this sort of an idea that science is God? Talk to me about it.
You can look in any area of science. Typically, when we're looking at origins, and that's what I call it, evolution versus creation. How did we get here? How did we start? We look in four basic areas. Geology, that is, we study rocks, and planet Earth is one area. All right. We can look in biology, that is human beings, people, plants, animals. We can look in astrophysics, that is, we can look up at the stars and we can study them and see how they work. We can also look at human culture. So you can take your pick. I remember my mentor, Dr. Walter Brown. When he had his programs, he would let the audience pick what area did they want to look in, all right? They could pick astrophysics. You know, usually we call that astronomy, but at the university we call it astrophysics. You can look at biology. You can look at chemistry, any area that you want to look. And, of course, then there's always the big area of specific areas in the Bible. The biggest one, of course, is Noah's flood. And it really gets a lot of interest because most people have been taught that Noah's flood is myth. It cannot happen. There's not enough water to cover Mount Everest. All the animals can't fit in the ark. All these kinds of things. If you're going to talk about origins, you must be conversant in all of them. So, Howard, I'm not going to pick for you. I'm going to let you pick. What do you want? What area do you want to engage? We can do astrophysics. We can do Noah's flood. We can do biology. We can do geology.
I'll take Noah's flood for 200, right? You know why? Okay. Let me tell you why. Right?
Okay.
Right. So I'm interested because, like I said, when we were younger, when I was younger, I'm in 40s now, right? When I was younger, there was only this cut and dry, this sort of a cookie cutter concept about what religion and faith was and our responsibility to adhere to a God that's watching over us, right? We're in a round world, we're in this. And as we evolve, as we grow, as we learn, as the world becomes a community, as opposed to, you know, this distance between us, you know, computers and technologies bring us closer. Conspiracy theories pop up. The world's flat. They've been lying to us. They've been doing this. They've been doing that. We're in a firmament. There is God separated the waters from the waters. And so when you start to talk about Noah's Ark, I am intrigued. Talk to me about from the perspective of Noah's Ark.
But before we get into the depth of that, let me take this quick commercial break and be right back after this.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
At Ron's Electric Motors, they repair and rewind all major brands of electric motors, including water pumps, generators, and the generator's back end, welding machines, electric lifts, air compressors, battery chargers, and more. They're equipped to handle up to 850 kilowatts and rewind up to 450 horsepower motors. They're conveniently located on the corner of Wolf and Clarence Roads and are open weekdays 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., Saturdays till noon. They offer 24 hours emergency assistance. You can reach them at 242-356-0249.
You've tried everything. Aces with your mother's cousin's sister's auntie, and even hiding your money under your mattress. But is your money safe? Your Bahamian dollar deposit in a member bank or credit union is insured up to $50,000. If anything happens, your deposit up to the insured value will be returned to you thanks to Deposit Insurance. Visit Deposit Insurance Corporation at www.dic.bf.
Protection for your money guaranteed with DIC.
Now, 96.9 FM radio, and we are back. The foundation, and we're getting into the foundation, possibly the firmament. We're getting into a couple of things now. Major, when we left off, you started to talk about something that always piques my interest. I don't know if it's we're swimming into the space of conspiracy, but you started to talk to us about Noah's Ark. Dive into it for us.
Okay, so essentially, if the flood story is true, evolution cannot be true, okay? And let me explain why. That is, if Noah's flood happened when the Bible says it happened and all life was eliminated, there's simply not enough time for evolution or anything else to possibly be true. So evolution and creation are, we call them, they're mutually exclusive. If you prove one, you disprove the other. If you disprove one, you prove the other, because they both cannot be true at the same time. All right. So Noah's Ark, if we can demonstrate that the flood actually happened and that it was a worldwide flood, you have disproved evolution. So let's take something that I say the kids love it, which is why I built the world's largest authentic model of Noah's Ark. Our Noah's Ark is the same scale as a Lionel train, 1 to 48. And even at that scale, Noah's Ark is 12 feet long. It's 2 feet wide and 2 feet high. It weighs 300 pounds. Now you say, well, how big, just to give you, how big would a human being be at that scale? A human being would be 1 inch tall. 1 inch tall, that's the size of a human being. And mm-hmm. Noah's Ark would be 12 feet long. So that's how giant.
That's
the
scale
was.
You give, okay.
That's the scale. If we, the first boat that was built that was larger than Noah's Ark was a very famous ship, probably the most famous ship that even in the world today, and that was the RMS Titanic.
The Titanic.
That was the largest laid down.
That one sank though.
Well, Noah's Ark didn't sink because of the way it was designed. Because Noah's Ark was not made out of lumber. It was made out of hewn logs. So it rode very low in the water. By itself, the ark would have been about 75 feet high, but it, once it was in the water, it would have only about been about 35 feet above the water line. So there was no way for the wind to really catch it. Mm. So it rode very well. It was very stable. But let's talk about the possibilities of Noah's Ark. It had 2.2 million cubic feet in it. Okay. The largest land animal in the world was a Brachiosaurus, mm-hmm. 70 feet long, about 70 feet high, 110,000 pounds. I know you're in the British system, so I don't know. Somebody's going to have to tell me how to do that in kilos. I don't know. That's 52 tons. And I don't know long tons from short tons, so somebody's going to have to get out their calculator and figure that. So one of the questions that people have is whether the animals could all fit on the ark. If you take an encyclopedia of life on Earth, biological life on the planet, we'll see that there are 90 different types of animals, 90 different classes of animals. And if you split that in the middle and you take 45, I invite students, I say, let's count all of those 90. Now, we don't have to, all we have to do is get to the middle. And let's start with the largest animals that we can have, even sea animals. And let's count to 45 and see if by the time we get to the middle, if we're not down to the size of the rat. And most of the, you take a Brachiosaurus. Now, of course, you eliminate animals. So a blue whale is the largest land animal that ever lives. So
he should be in the ocean.
Water, so they can stay in the ocean.
Right.
Then we come to a Brachiosaurus, all right?
Mm-hmm.
Then we come down to a T-Rex and an elephant are about 6,000 pounds, so they're about the same weight. Many people don't know what the second largest land animal is today. Do you know, Howard? Number two. Everyone knows an elephant's the first largest. Who's number one? Who's number two?
Is it a rhinoceros or hippopotamus?
Yes, you're right. Yes, you're right. A rhinoceros. Okay. Many people don't know that. They think it's a hippo. Mm-hmm. But a rhino is much bigger than a hippo.
Mm-hmm.
And then as you count your way down, elephant seals, beach masters, which are walrus, of course, they can live in the water. So and that's where they live. So you eliminate them. By the time you get down to about 42 or 43, you didn't even get halfway. You're down to a rat.
So you're saying to me. Because when we start to talk about bronchiosaurus and when we start to talk about these particular things, I'd like to know whether or not you're saying to me during this time and era that Noah existed, that these humongous animals, whether you're going to call it a woolly mammoth, do you believe that this existed during this time? Is that what you're saying?
Well, of course, woolly mammoths, we know those existed after the flood because we have preserved carcasses.
Right.
Not fossils, we have preserved carcasses. But so the issue is, And of course, we have drawings, so that's easy. We know those existed after the flood and during the Ice Age. The dinosaurs, of course, they lived at the same time as human beings because we have human descriptions of them. Many people do not know this. Yes, they survived the flood. Not all of them. I'm not saying that every species of dinosaur survived the flood because once the vegetation was torn up, many of them went extinct. But of course, even in the Bible, we have Job telling us about the Leviathan and the behemoth.
Mm-hmm.
We have drawings of a Stegosaurus in China. So yes, they lived at the same time as human beings, and many of them survived the flood and eventually went extinct. We have found mummified carcasses of duck-billed dinosaurs. And this is not a fossil now. Okay, this is a mummified carcass. So yes, dinosaurs survived the flood, and the evidence shows this. Okay,
but so the evidence is saying to me that there is, because I've always wrestled with this as a child. I when you know growing up, I don't know how my kids got into it, but they were heavy. My son knows what a T-Rex is. He knows what is all the dinosaurs. He knows all these, right? My oldest son. He was heavy on this, and I never got into it as a child because I threw this out of my mind. As a child, I never saw these humongous animals being able to coexist with human beings. And so, you know, are you saying to me now, based upon the science that exists here, that there was this kind of a coexistence in this space? Talk to me about it.
Well, of course they did. That is, God created all the animals. He created them in the first week of creation. He created all of them as well as man. So yes, contrary to what we've been taught in an evolutionary model, all of these animals have coexisted.
This is an amazing thing that you're doing.
And of course, we can see this in the record in the geologic column. So we have what we call polystrate fossils. That is, it's a fossil that goes through more than one level of sedimentary rock. Mm-hmm. We have trees that extend through many layers, fossilized trees. So what this tells us is that these strata, these geologic strata, were laid down very rapidly. They were not laid down over millions and millions of years. A limestone precipitates, that is, it rains out of water. Mm-hmm. So you could not have a what we call a polystrate fossil, a fossilized tree extending through these strata, each strata is supposed to be millions of years. That's absolutely impossible.
Mm.
Absolutely.
You're blowing my mind today. I am here looking at stalactites and stalagmites in my mind, and I'm just going through the entire process as a child learning these things. I think we've gotten so caught up in this kind of a rat race that we push these things aside. And I don't know whether or not we are doing enough in this era to kind of teach our children about these things, because, I mean, you're blowing my mind. I want to ask you a question. I want to ask you this question, though, because you brought up the ark. Does that ever lead into this concept and idea between faith and science about being able to prove whether or not we're in a sphere or whether or not this is a flat world? Does it ever lead into that when you start to have this kind of a Noah's Ark conversation?
Well, even the ancients knew that the world was round. And of course, during an eclipse, you can see the shadow of the earth on the moon and it's curved. So of course they knew it was round. Mm-hmm. When a ship is at sea, it raises as it comes up over the horizon. So, of course, the ancients knew that the world was round. And, of course, the Bible says that God suspends the earth on nothing. Mm-hmm. So that was never an issue. Most of those superstitions came many, many centuries after the flood, mostly during the Dark Ages, when people were cut off from science or literacy or knowledge. Mm. So you can plainly see that the earth is round. And of course, the Bible does not teach that the earth is flat.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm blown away about this. So tell me about some of the stuff that you're going to be talking about on day one, evolution and creation. What's the concept and idea, or the approach rather, that you're going to be able to take to kind of mount that conversation?
Mm-hmm. Well, usually we start with the major postulates of the two major origin theories. Evolution has four major postulates or ideas upon which it is based, and creation also has four major postulates on which it is based. And when we're talking about science, the first thing we have to start with is, what is science? Okay, science is the use of observation, record keeping, controlled analysis of the empirical world that can be falsified by others. That is science. That's real science. I'll repeat that again. Science is the use of observation. That is something you can see, touch, and feel. Mm-hmm. Observation, record keeping, you wrote it down, mm-hmm. a person wrote it down, all right, of the empirical world. That is something that you can knock on, that you can see, touch, and feel.
Tangible.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Which somebody else can prove to be wrong, which is falsifiable. If you cannot prove something true, you can't prove it false.
Mm.
So based on that definition, neither evolution or creation is science technically, because it was never observed. No one saw God speak the world into existence. No one saw that. No one saw animals, fish evolve into cows. So no one saw it. So neither one is science. What we're actually doing is we're relying on what we call scientific inference. That is, we infer about origins from the current science that we can see. It's called scientific inference. And using scientific inference, there are four evolutionary postulates. And all four of the evolutionary postulates have been scientifically proven to be false. All right, let's talk about them. Postulate number one for evolution, that life comes from non-life. And first we show students, we say, evolution is based on this idea that life comes from non-life. That has been proven to be false. In the early 1860s, Louis Pasteur proved that spontaneous generation was false. He sterilized a beaker with a broth in it, and then he covered the top to see, that is, if it would ferment. And it did not, because it was sterile. If you keep bacteria out, nothing can get in. That is, people used to believe that if you put little grains of wheat and rags together, that mice grew from grains of wheat and rags, right? Now, of course, you can do that experiment today, right? The same thing will happen. If you put it outside and you put a little food there and you put rags together, yes, if you pull it away, you'll find mice. But we interpret it differently, right?
Mm-hmm.
No one would think that the mice come from the wheat and the rags. If you put a screen around it, it'll be empty. So there's no evidence that life comes from non-life. Absolutely none. It has been proven to be false. That's the first postulate of evolution. The second major postulate of evolution is that complex plant and animal life, including humans, come from single-cell life forms. All right? And what most people don't know is that while we have single-cell life forms, and we call it bacteria, we have no 2, 3, 4, or even 5-celled life forms. So there's a huge jump. We go from single-cell bacteria to these complex life forms, complex cells. There's a huge jump there, and that evolution cannot bridge that. There's no evidence that all life today comes from single-cell life forms. Mm-hmm. So the second postulate.
What is the closest that you found? What is the closest that science has found to being the closest to the single cell life, the single cell life form?
Well, that is a single cell bacteria. Of course, is very complex. It has a motor, right? It has bearings. It has they have a propeller. Even a single cell, a single human cell, has millions and billions of parts.
Mm-hmm.
A strand of DNA is over 6 feet long. It has millions and billions of codes in it. So even a single cell is complex beyond our wildest imagination,
mm-hmm.
right? And we're not even talking about larger life forms, complex life forms.
Wow.
Even bacteria are complex. We cannot create a bacteria cell.
So it's essentially this second prospect is really saying that from simplicity came this kind of the evolution of interest. That's talk to me about that. But before we get into that, you got to let me get to this commercial break, get to news, and be right back. After this.
Craving an authentic calzone? Well, make the right choice at Marco's Pizza. Our signature calzones feature our handmade dough,
stuffed with toppings,
our fresh 3-cheese blend, served with a side of pizza sauce. For a limited time, order 2. That's right, 2 of our 2-topping calzones and 1 liter Coke
for only $15.
Restrictions apply. Customize your calzones right now at marcospizzabahamas.com. Now closing at 11:30 p.m. on Fridays and Saturdays.
The Grand Bahama News is available every Tuesday in the Nassau Guardian. Buy your local paper at Freeport convenience stores, Western Bakery, DeGregory's Fine Foods, and Bellevue Gifts. Want to reach your Grand Bahama customers? Then call Barefoot Marketing at 827-4578 or message them for ad rates via their Facebook page. Advertising opportunities now include classified ads too. Keep up with all the latest Grand Bahama News in the Nassau Guardian newspaper every Tuesday.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
We've been with you from the very start, leading the way and providing you with the best in primetime sporting experiences.
From Nassau, Bahama, Ty Jones.
From one goal to the next, you can count on us for full access to the best sports channels at home or on the go. Make Rev your only choice. Visit Rev.bs. Every match, every game, every moment. Rev, your home for sports. America
completely run out of it. At Ron's Electric Motors, they repair and rewind all major brands of electric motors, including water pumps, generators, and the generator's back end, welding machines, electric lifts, air compressors, battery chargers, and more. They're equipped to handle up to 850 kilowatts and rewind up to 450 horsepower motors. They're conveniently located on the corner of Wolf and Clarence Roads and are open weekdays 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., Saturdays till noon. They offer 24 hours emergency assistance. You can reach them on 242-356-0249.
Struggling to repay your loan? Let us help you get back on track with payment terms that suits your financial situation and improve your credit score and credit report with the Bahamas Credit Bureau. Inquire about our restructured loans today. Call us at 356-7764.
You've tried everything. ASUS, with your mother's cousin, sister's auntie, and even hiding your money under your mattress. But is your money safe? Your Bahamian dollar deposit in a member bank or credit union is insured up to $50,000. If anything happens, your deposit up to the insured value will be returned to you thanks to Deposit Insurance. Visit Deposit Insurance Corporation at www.dic.bs.
Protection for your money guaranteed with DIC.
It's the Battle of the Bra, sponsored by Canoe, and you decide who wins. October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month, so strap on your gloves and join the fight. It's easy. Just download the Canoe app, vote for Mammogram Access Program, the Grand Bahama Cancer Society, or Sister Sister, or go to the Battle of the Bra event page on Facebook and vote. Each vote is just $5. Polls open on October 2nd and close on October 26th. Vote as many times as you want. You can even vote for all three. It's the Battle of the Bra. The winner will be announced on Friday, October 27th at the Pink Lotus Affair at Blair House.
This is my fight song. Take back my life song. Prove I'm alright song.
Beulah Gal, can you believe this? We are now the patrol queens of the neighborhood.
We now large and in charge. So we need to check out what's going on in everybody yard. What about that gun that we know that Junior and his homeboys just ran out? Can we report that too?
Of course we can.
But we could be in deep trouble if they find out.
We need to report what we see, Beulah. When you call Crime Stoppers, they just answer your call in Miami.
So then we can report everything? Guns? Where they hiding the drugs? Who shoot who? Who part of which gang? Or who disturbing the peace with the loud music and the motorcycles?
Then our neighborhood will be the best in the Bahamas, and everybody gonna want to come live here. And then our house price will go up, gal.
So what we waiting on? What's the number?
If you see something, say something. Let us all pitch in and stop the crime before it's your time. Call 328-8477 from Nassau, or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands, or text us through the Crack Crime Bahamas app. Stop the crime before it's your time.
Loss of family members is very isolating, and people who have experienced loss appreciate when others have shared their grief. If you can't be there in person, go to the Nassau Guardian's website online at thenassauguardian.com and visit our obituary link. The Nassau Guardian's interactive obituary link allows you to read the funeral announcement, express condolences, or place photos on the online guestbook for one full year. Losing a loved one is painful, but that pain isn't the worst thing to happen. Friends, loved ones, colleagues, and neighbors who ignore the loss compound the pain. Should the bereaved family wish to place the obituary and photos on our obituary site, just contact the Guardian's funeral industry partners or the Nassau Guardian. Remember, there isn't one magic right thing to say to someone experiencing loss that will make the loss less painful or easier to bear. The Nassau Guardian's obituary link, available online at thenassauguardian.com.
Thank you.
your print needs are short or long run, digital printing, wide format, or print consultation, call the best. Call Printmasters. They have been in the printing business since 1957 and are a printing company with a tradition of excellence. The goal of Printmasters is to provide their clients with the highest levels of personal and professional service at an affordable price, along with the technology that makes working together efficient and easy. Lamination, business cards, flyers, posters, window and floor decals, and just a few of the digitized printing services offered at Printmasters. Call 302-2361 and print with the best. Print with Printmasters.
The new Guardian Radio app is here. Listen live to all our Guardian Radio shows and live video stream select programs in our studio. Get information about Guardian Radio shows and our hosts. Send messages, including text, email, and even call. All from our amazing new Guardian Radio app. Download it free today in your App Store for your Apple device or Play Store for your Android device. The all-new and improved Guardian Radio app.
At a time when jobs are hard to find, crime is a concern, and Bahamians are uncertain about the future of the country, there is one paper you can rely on as your source of news and commentary. The Nassau Guardian delves deeper into the issues. We ask the tough questions. We tell your stories. If you haven't already, pick up a copy today. The Nassau Guardian. News and views that matter since 1844.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
You're listening to news headlines on the hour over the Guardian Radio Network. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Jared Higgs. Thanks so much for joining us. Here's what our news team is working on. A 43-year-old gynecologist has been charged with performing an illegal abortion on a pregnant teen. Dr. Jamil Minnis, the son of former Prime Minister Dr. Hubert Minnis, is charged along with the 15-year-old's mother and sister. Their names have been withheld to conceal the identity of the minor. The women, ages 48 and 25, are charged with conspiracy to commit abortion and abortion, while Minnis is charged with abortion. The conspiracy allegedly occurred between September 3rd and 4th, and the abortion allegedly took place on September 4th in Harbour Island, Eleuthera. The accused were not required to enter pleas to the charges when they appeared before a senior magistrate, Shaka Serville, and were denied bail. They are awaiting an emergency bail hearing in the Supreme Court. In other news, a man and the female passenger on his motorcycle are dead after the driver of another vehicle tried to overtake and collided with them head-on. Another female passenger on the motorcycle was seriously injured, as was the driver of the Mitsubishi vehicle that tried to overtake. Police say the incident unfolded at around 2 a.m. on East Street South near Calvary Deliverance Church. The driver of the Mitsubishi was driving south and tried to overtake another vehicle heading south. That's when he collided with the motorbike with its three passengers heading north on the same street. And declaring himself the people's choice, former PLP Cabinet Minister Shane Gibson was on the ground in West Grand Bahama this weekend in full campaign mode. That despite his party chairman's declaration that former PLP MPs will not be considered for the nomination to possibly fill that seat left vacant by the late Obi Wilchcombe. During a memorial held for Wilchcombe at Bishop Michael Eldon Auditorium in Grand Bahama on Friday, Gibson recounted his close friendship with the area's former MP and reminded that Wilchcombe also pushed back against the political forces who did not want him to campaign for that seat in 2021, and eventually proved to be an excellent addition to a rebranded PLP.
Following the loss of the seat in the 2017 general election, Obi faced challenges in his return to frontline politics. The political landscape had changed, and the party had undergone a transformation with a reformed and rebranded image. Some questioned whether the return of former members of the Christie administration, including Obi, was in line with this new vision. But Obi knew something that his detractors seemed to overlook. He understood the good he could do and the invaluable experience he could bring to the team. He believed in the power of his ideas and the impact they could have on the Bahamians everywhere. And so he pressed forward, undeterred by the doubts and criticisms. In his 2 years as a minister in this administration, Obi proved his worth time and time again. Through innovative policies and dogged dedication, OBE demonstrated that experience and expertise can indeed be assets to a party's reformed and rebranded image. Its detractors were proven wrong as he tirelessly worked to improve the lives of those in need.
You were listening to News Headlines on the Hour over the Guardian Radio Network. On behalf of the entire Guardian News team, I'm Jared Higgs. Thanks so much for joining us, and tune at the top of every hour for the latest news updates.
Good morning. I'm Ed Donahue with an AP News Minute. More than 1 million Palestinians in Gaza have left their homes ahead of an expected Israeli ground offensive. Here's the AP's Karen Chamas.
Israeli forces, supported by U.S. warships, have gathered along the Gaza border and are preparing for what Israel says will be a broad campaign to dismantle Hamas. Aid groups warn an Israeli ground offensive could hasten a humanitarian crisis. A week of blistering airstrikes have demolished neighborhoods, but have failed to stop militant rocket fire into Israel. The war began on October the 7th and has become the deadliest of five Gaza wars for both sides, with thousands dead. I'm Karen Chamas.
Secretary of State Antony Blinken renewed pledges of American support for Israel in the war with Hamas as he returned to the country for the second time in less than a week. Blinken also briefed Israelis about discussions he had with Arab leaders on the conduct of the war and the need to protect civilians. I'm Ed Donahue.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
FM Radio, Howard Grenier Company, beautiful Monday afternoon, live and in full effect. Still here, really being able to chop it down as we have a great conversation. I'm hoping that you're intrigued, that I truly am, about this kind of a conversation, talking with none other than Major Coleman, really being able to break down the science of this thing. And definitely here with Sandra Burrows, all the way from the Seventh Day Adventist Church. They're bringing to us October 26th, this great, great event where Creation Sabbath, they're going to be talking about it and talking about evolution or creation. They have Major Coleman here. And Major, so when we left off, you started to talk about, I think, these two postulates. I'm sure that we're going to get into two more. Talk to me about it.
Yes.
Is that
we
what
have, we have no. We have no evidence that single-cell life evolved into larger life forms.
Wow.
There is no evidence of that. None whatsoever. So that has been the explosion of life in the Cambrian layer. We go from the Precambrian layer in geology, where we have zip, no life, to the Cambrian layer, where we have complex life forms, worms, shells, trilobites. These are complex life forms, and we have nothing in between. So the second postulate has been proven to be false. The third postulate upon which evolution is based is that the process which drives it forward is time and chance and natural selection. And this is probably the strongest area for creation. The probability of just a simple protein, and a protein is a long string of amino acids. Mm-hmm. A short one is 100 units long in exact sequence. The probability of a 100-unit protein assembling itself is 10 to the 116. That's 10 with 116 zeros after it. Now, that's a big number. We don't even have a name for it. We don't even have a name for a number that size, okay?
Yeah.
But what people, just to give you an idea how big a number that is, all the atoms in the visible universe are only 10 to the 70. All the atoms in the universe are only 10 to the 70.
On the head of a pin. So the probability is extremely high. It's never going to happen.
No, that's right. It is impossible. The probability of one 100-unit protein, that is not a cell. That's just a small part of a cell. That's not a cell. Just a 100-unit protein is 10 to the 116. There are only 10 to the 70 atoms in the universe. Imagine the primordial soup, which never existed. If you had a lightning bolt striking this soup a million times every second for a billion years, do you know what number that is? That's only 10 to the 40. That's not, and you have to get to 10 to the 116. It's just impossible. Time and chance are not evolution's friend, it's their enemy. Evolutionary postulate number 4, the evidence for major evolutionary processes, that is fish turning into cows, is minor genetic variation within species. That is, that cats have different colors, that dogs are different colors and different sizes. That proves that fish turned into birds. Gregor Mendel showed, again, in the 19th century, in the 1800s, he worked with peas. He said, all you're showing is that the different genes were reshuffled. There are no new genes created. That cats have different colors, you're just mixing cats. You're not creating a cat. That is, you're mixing dogs, but you don't create a dog cat. There's no such thing. You can't interbreed them. There are very limits. There are limits in how far we can go with genes. So no new genes have been produced. So, all the four postulates of evolution have been proven to be false, okay, as opposed to the four postulates of creation have all been proven to be true.
Give me the fourth postulate again, because I get the first three. The one, life comes from non-life, that's the first postulate. The second one, you says life comes from a single cell. And then you said the third one was time and chance develops it, right? And what's the fourth one?
The fourth one is that evolution is shown by minor genetic variation. Minor genetic variation that we see today. So we have cats of different colors. We even have people with different amounts of melanin in their skin, mm-hmm, right? And evolutionists take that to say that proves that fish turned into birds, or fish turned into cows, or fish turned into horses. And minor genetic variation does not prove anything. It only proves that all the genes were there from the beginning.
Is this relentless pursuit to reject the concept and idea of a deity of supremacy that exists above us? Is this pursuit to reject the idea that a being would come down and develop us based upon the word of God that speaks to us about the fact that we were molded or formed from the ground, from the dirt? Is this these four postulates in pursuit of the fact that they are, that life has evolved by itself, that life can be able to continue to evolve by itself, that it came from a non-living, these things don't even make sense. So talk to me about the why, right? Talk to me about the why. Why is this concept? Why is science relentlessly pursuing to be able to dissect and find something that they just can't prove?
Well, there are many reasons, Howard, but I'm going to tell you the reason that may shock you. And one of the main reasons, if we go back, science, evolutionary science, you have to realize this, was created during the African slave trade. One of the reasons is because our love for racism and white supremacy. That is, evolution is inherently racist.
Hold on, Major. This is major conversation that you're having right here. This has evolved. This conversation has evolved. You have taken it from the concept and idea of the creation, the being the tangibility, the flesh and blood, into the concept and idea of racism entrapped in our mind. That's the mental slavery that we continue to grapple with here as a people, especially as an ethnic race, about our allegiance. Should our allegiance be to the white man? Should our allegiance be to the blue-eyed Jesus? Should our allegiance be to these particular things? Are you taking it in that course? Talk to me about it.
Well, the three founders of evolutionary theory, Charles Darwin, Alfred Wallace, and Herbert Spencer, the three founders of evolution were all British, and they all had anti-black ideas, which we would today call racist. That is, their nation, Britain, of course, was the chief slave transporter. Britain itself never had slavery on British soil, but they were the chief, it was British ships that transported the slaves for the Dutch, for the Portuguese, for the Spanish. And of course, African slavery made Britain rich. So, and the fact that science, the slave trade, and evolution grew up together, they started at the same time, and they were used to support each other.
Wow.
Darwin was a racist. He said that black people, he was an anti-black. What surprised me about Darwin, that is, he was an anti-black racist. That is, you can be a racist, and of course we have many different ethnicities.
Mm-hmm.
Why was he so opposed to African Americans that they walk like on all fours?
Mm-hmm.
That's what he said in mm-hmm. The Descent of Man. That was certainly not necessary, or if he was going to think that, he could say it about other indigenous peoples. Why just about Africans? Why? Because, of course, they supported his lifestyle. That is, it was in Darwin's interest.
It's peculiar that you would take this angle, and I'm telling you, this is very interesting. Ladies and gentlemen, you have to go to the Faith and Science Weekend, October 26th, to be able to find out more from Major Coleman, to be able to talk about these things. He hit me with the postulates. The postulates, based upon the base, doesn't make any sense to me, right? Why do we continue to break these things out? And then you go to the African slave trade. And if you're going to be very clear and honest about this, the conversations that we have is that there's always this picture that we've seen as Christopher Columbus, or, you know, the crew came over to Africa. They genuflected and bowed and gave you the Bible. And as you prayed their prayer, they took your land, right? And then this kind of an exchange. So if that is the core premise and idea of how this inception of slavery even started, from our perspective, the question that I have is that why now would the supreme beings during this particular time, because we were only three-fifths man, why would they try to create a prospect, an idea, to be able to dismantle even an idea of supremacy in our heads? That's peculiar to me.
Well, the evolutionary science was used to support African subjugation. And it grew up with American culture, but more specifically, it grew up with white American culture. That is, black Americans, and I'm sorry that I don't have data for the Caribbean, but white Americans black Americans are the only racial group where the majority believe the literal Genesis story of the Bible. Most whites do not, most Latinos.
But black Americans represent some 13% of America, 350 million people.
Yeah.
So
that is good. So, but they are in a distinct minority. Evolution has really taken its hold in the university, in the academy, where it's really built in and drilled into the heads of students, many of whom do not understand that also it's tied to America's history of anti-black racism.
Mm.
And of course, it's my job to make that clear to them, okay? And to show them that the origin theories held by most black people, that the science supports their origin theories and not the ideas of whites. Origin theories are highly correlated with race. Highly correlated with race. The primary origin theory of whites is evolution. The origin theory of blacks is creation.
Well, Major, we're going to have further conversations about this, but we're going to have to do this. And I know that there are a great deal of my brothers and sisters out there that's looking forward to having this kind of a conversation. Sandra, I hope you're still with us as we continue to talk about this. The Faith and Science Weekend is going to be kicking off October 26th. That's next weekend. They're going to do this over at the University of the Bahamas. They're going to have several different approaches. Sandra, is there a way that we can be able to reach out to them? Is there like a Facebook page, or is there further information for anyone who wants to actually kind of check the information out?
It will be streamed on YouTube. Mm-hmm. The South Bahamas Conference website will also be streaming it as well as the Hillview Seventh-day Adventist Church will be streaming all the programs on that Saturday. Now, of course, the advantage of coming out to the events, especially the Sabbath afternoon, where there will be an interaction, and the Thursday night, is that you can ask as many questions as you would like. Yeah, of Major.
Right. Don't do that.
If you can't make it,
wouldn't go home. Major, tell your wife now, you ain't coming home. If you open up for questions, you'll be there for 2 days.
Join us on YouTube if you can't make it in person. We would still love to have you.
And that's going to be on October 26th. Let them know exactly where it's going to be again.
At the University of the Bahamas, the 26th at 6 p.m. That will be in the library auditorium, the 8 p.m. library auditorium. And then on the Saturday, there's an 8 o'clock session at the Grandstown Seventh-day Adventist Church, 9:45 at the Hillview Church on Tonic Williams Darling Highway. That runs into the 11 o'clock presentation, and then at 4:30 also at the Hillview Church.
Well, Major Coleman, I want to say to you, I am grateful for the existence of your son. Can I say that right? That his life alone has led you into a space that your mind blossomed to kind of bring this information to all of us to talk about it. I am intrigued, and I want to know more about At Dawn We Slept. I know that we don't have time to talk about it, but if you guys are out there and you want to be able to be a part of this, please do so. This is the Faith and Science Weekend, October 26th with World Church. They're going to be doing all of this great stuff on the Creation Sabbath, and they're going to be doing this here to talk about these things. These postulates are blowing my mind. I mean, I'm sure I'm going to go to do some more studies on some stuff. I got to check this out. And what's crazy, Major, is how you tied it into African slave trade. I think this is extremely interesting, my brother.
Well, I didn't do that. Darwin did it himself. He did it for me.
This is crazy. I thank you, man. I thank you. I look forward to it. Is this going to be your first time in the Bahamas?
Yes, it is, actually. And my wife is looking forward to it.
You can't bring that little boat with you. You say you got a 12-foot Noah's Ark. You won't be able to bring that with you.
I tried, but there's just no way.
No, man. No. It's going to be much. But we pretty appreciate it, man. Bring your pictures. Bring all the stuff. The 1-inch scale is something to see also. So, guys, listen, this is a beautiful thing. Please be a part of it. Sandra, you said there's anything that they can reach out. They don't have to register. They don't have to do anything like that.
No registration required.
No registration required.
Exactly.
Okay. University of Bahamas. And if you guys want to find out more about it, hit me up, 8270111, 8270111. I'll shoot you a flyer so you can be able to see all the information out there. Major Coleman, are you on the internet anywhere that persons can be able to reach out to you?
Yes, I am. They can find me at powerstation.org. That's one word, powerstation.org.
PowerStation.org.
Send me an email, major@powerstation.org, you can find.
Okay. Well, thank you so very kindly for being able to tune in with us and listen to this. Let me take this commercial break and be right back after this.
At Ron's Electric Motors, they repair and rewind all major brands of electric motors, including water pumps, generators, and the generator's back end, welding machines, electric lifts, air compressors, battery chargers, and more. They're equipped to handle up to 850 kilowatts and rewind up to 450 horsepower motors. They're conveniently located on the corner of Wolf and Clarence Roads and are open weekdays 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. Saturdays till noon. They offer 24 hours emergency assistance. You can reach them at 242-356-0249.
It's the Battle of the Bras, sponsored by Canoe, and you decide who wins. October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month, so strap on your gloves and join the fight. It's easy. Just download the Canoe app,
Vote for Mammogram Access Program, the Grand Bahama Cancer Society, or Sister Sister, or go to the Battle of the Bra event page on Facebook and vote. Each vote is just $5. Polls open on October 2nd and close on October 26th. Vote as many times as you want. You can even vote for all three. It's the Battle of the Bra. The winner will be announced on Friday, October 27th at the Pink Lotus Affair at Blair House.
This is my fight song. Take back my life song. Prove I'm all right song.
It's Whopper Wednesday every Wednesday at Burger King Nassau. Make your Wednesday sizzle and sink your teeth into a flame-grilled beef patty topped with tomatoes, fresh-cut lettuce, mayo, pickles, ketchup, and sliced onions, all on a toasted sesame seed bun with fries for only $5.95. Including that, this Whopper Wednesday, grab a friend and head down to your favorite BK Nassau location for a flame-grilled Whopper made your way with crisp fries for only $5.95. Burger King Nassau, where taste is king.
Guardian Radio and the Foundation are on the move.
Bahamas, this one's for you.
SBT. Small Business Thursdays. Every Thursday, the Foundation with Howard Grant will highlight small businesses throughout the country, far and wide. Your products, services, prices, and personality. We want to hear it all. Get your 30 or 60 second advertisement heard on air at a fraction of the cost. We here at the Foundation understand the times and don't want you to be left behind. With Guardian Radio, you reach your specific demographic and it is unmatched.
We reach thousands daily.
Get your products off the shelf and your services in their hearts. Small Business Thursdays with the Foundation, only on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. For more information, call 302-2300 or the Help Me Howard line at 827-0111. SBT. Small Business Thursdays. Get your business moving today.
Let me ask you a few questions. What's your name?
Pam.
Favorite food?
Steak.
Beer or wine?
Wine.
Is your money safe?
It's under my beds, I guess so.
Are you serious?
Yeah, why?
Unless your money is in a bank or credit union that's a member of the Deposit Insurance Corporation, there's no guarantee it's safe.
Yeah, but what if something happens to the bank?
Your Bahamian dollar deposits are insured up to $50,000, so you'd still be ahead. Plus, your mattress might catch fire. Then what?
Man, those banks and credit unions are looking good right about now.
Visit the DIC's website at www.dic.bs. Protection for your money, guaranteed with DIC.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
You've tried everything. Aces, with your mother's cousin, sister's auntie, and even hiding your money under your mattress. But is your money safe? Your Bahamian dollar deposit in a member bank or credit union is insured up to $50,000. If anything happens, your deposit up to the insured value will be returned to you thanks to Deposit Insurance. Visit Deposit Insurance Corporation at www.dic.bs.
Protection for your money, guaranteed with DIC.
We've been with you from the very start, leading the way and providing you with the best in primetime sporting experiences. From one goal to the next, you can count on us for full access to the best sports channels at home or on the go. Make Rev your only choice. Visit Rev.bs. Every match, every game, every moment. Rev, your home for sports.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Here I am, and it is
afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. 96.9 FM radio, Howard Grantley Company, the foundation, and we are back. Back in the new year. Y'all need to stop, right? It's a beautiful day. So happy to have you here with us. It's a beautiful Monday. I think it's overcast today, right? But it's a gorgeous day. I'm so happy to be able to be here in your company, kind of chopping these things down. I want to thank the Seventh-day Adventist Church for being able to sit with us. I was extremely intrigued when they started to talk about this concept and idea about faith and science, right? It's peculiar, you know. Let's just be decent. It's peculiar how we're seeing the University of the Bahamas open to all and sundry. That's what it seems like. To have a conversation with the faculty and staff, or the faculty and staff rather, having an opportunity to be able to bring in the church, the Seventh-day Adventist Church, to be able to have these kind of a conversation, does it lend some balance to what we would have seen the other day with the LGBTQIA+, right? Just me being decent. I'm sure they have some more acronyms. It's crazy, right? But is it the University of the Bahamas being able to lend their air, their conversation, their space to voices in the diaspora, to voices that doesn't necessarily align with the tradition and the, you know, is consistent rather with the condition or position of a great deal of things that's in the tradition, right? Does that make sense? I just want to say that because I saw it and I say, wow, okay. University of the Bahamas is still being able to open their space to this. I understand, right? I suppose in that kind of a space of a university, you have to be nonpartisan and non-binary. Was that too much? I think it was. But I'm grateful for them. I'm grateful for all of them. Guys, if you want to be able to go down and check it out, like I said, October 26th, go down there and check out Major Coleman and Sandra Burrows. Like I said, she is from the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And I'm grateful. I'm grateful for them to kind of sit with me and bring some edification, some information, some enlightenment on a great deal of the things that we kind of wrestle with. And you know what? I had to hold myself back in the conversation because I feel like I was slipping in the darkness. Yeah, I feel like I was slipping into that kind of a space where conspiracy theory becomes rather buoyant. It bubbles to the surface. You know what I mean? Like an intolerant blackhead that, you know what I mean? It's too much. And so I tried to pull myself back from it because as we started to talk and talk about Noah's Ark and talk about Moses came up in my mind in Exodus, I think, 2, when he was with, was it Jethro? When he just found him and he took him in, right? He took Moses in and gave him one of his daughters. I thought this is wild. He was the priest of that particular space. His daughters came in and say, oh, these guys just help us. And he just helped us. And he said, what? Did you leave them out there? And you leave the fellow out there? What kind of indecent children? Y'all go get the man. Brought him in and he ended up with one of the children and got her pregnant. And so I'm looking at this and I said to myself, I'm listening to these conspiracy theories and it goes back and forward from the stories that we were told as children and what we came to learn and understand through a great deal of our studies. And so I'm looking at it and I got to pull back from conspiracy theories because there are many stories that I would have read that spoke to the firmament, that spoke to the firmament being able to be cracked and water coming from under the ground and from the firmament atop. And it's a lot. So if you want to be able to get edified and get clarification on some things, if you're muddy as it relates to faith and science and the inception thereof, then because far too long, like I said, what we've done is been able to keep faith in one bucket and science in another. And the two should never be able to meet, right? But I think in this day and time, I don't know whether or not this is the agenda, that everything merges. There is an intersection for everything. Is that in preparation again for another conspiracy, one world religion? This is too much. I need to stop. Yeah, because when we see these things growing up,
there was a very, very sharp contrast that existed. And we knew that this is the side of the fence that we wanted to be on, that we were conditioned to be on. But as time progresses, we find ourselves almost like how George Bush calls Kerry, on the fence, flip-flopping between convictions, concepts, ideas, positions. It's too much. It is too much. But you know, I'm grateful for the opportunity to be able to do these things. Y'all know how my mind is working. I'm out here trying to figure these things out and make a determination as to whether or not we're in the right space and place to be able to move with progression and purpose. That's just what it is. That's just what it is, right? Over the weekend, I saw the prime minister being able to take pictures, and I was supposed to do an entire show on this, you know. I saw the prime minister sitting with the Pope. This is bananas. I saw the prime minister sitting with the Pope. I don't know whether or not under the last administration, we would have actually visited the Vatican. Did we under the last administration? Did we visit the Vatican under the last administration? I could be wrong, but I don't think we did. But I know that we did during the last PLP dispensation. I know that we did. I know that we did because I remember also very clearly after the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, the Minister of Foreign Affairs returned and gave a certain position and started to speak about the necessity for being able to align ourselves with global thinking. You remember this? And then it was a significant rift between not necessarily the church, quote unquote, but definitely Miles Monroe took a very, very strong approach in being able to refute this kind of an idea and spoke specifically about the sovereignty of a nation. Have we done away with that? Or is this just being able to acknowledge and genuflect to the powers that be? Is this an anticipation for alignment? What is going on? What is going on? I need to understand. I need to understand the objectives beyond the position. What is going on? The head of state is the Anglican Church in the Bahamas. The head of state is the Anglican Church. And who is the head of the Anglican Church? King Charles. Our allegiance tossed to and fro like strangers in the night. It's just too much. When are we going to pay allegiance to the Bahamian people? When are we going to commit ourselves to an idea for growth and development and understand the strength thereof? Why is it a necessity to be able to identify ourselves in strategic positions, always genuflecting and kissing the ring? And I would say proverbial, but I feel like this is a literal thing. This is bananas. It is absolutely bananas to me. I'm looking at it. And I understand that this is a good look for our prime minister. And that's don't fight. I'm not going to fight him. I can't. I cannot take on a position to fight the prime minister in his aspirations. In fact, I think it's admirable. I admire it. It's admirable that his aspirations pushes far beyond the borders of the Bahamas. And I said to you before, I feel like this is two campaigns running concurrently. Look at what I'm telling you. Y'all, listen to me. You remember the commercial? You remember the commercial way back in the day? You could learn a lot from a dummy when the dummies would crash the cars, right? And they'll show us what would happen with a dummy. You could learn a lot from a dummy. Listen to me. There are two campaigns running simultaneously in this country. And if you're going to play oblivious to it, if you're going to play naive, if you're going to play like, well, you know, I don't really, okay, then you get what you deserve. You get what you deserve. But if you want to be very clear about what's happening in this country, if you want to be honest, transparent, open, and allow yourself to be able to ingest the environment for what it is, not what you perceive it to be, not through the lens of your politics, your position, your faith, your idea. If you look at the raw elements of what is happening around you, you have to ask yourself this question. who is for us. And I don't believe that we're finding that. I don't believe that we're finding that sort of allegiance that we're looking for. There's no one for us. There is no one for the Bahamian people. There's a campaign, that these two campaigns that I'm talking about, amidst what's happening in preparation for a by-election, in preparation for and amidst a cabinet member, cabinet minister, losing his life, dying, unexpected. I don't think no one expected this to happen. A cabinet minister actually lost his life. And our prime minister, Minister of Foreign Affairs, and others, whoever this contingent was, found it necessary. This is our responsibility to state. Howard, this is the responsibility for being able to. I understand this. I'm not naive. Howard, this was already on the agenda. I'm not naive. But there's something has to take some kind of a solemn approach. There has to be some sort of this idea of sobriety and a solemn approach to be able to deal with some things. That's just how I feel. And I hate to say that. I hate to say how I feel, because it feels mad emotional. It's really not emotion. It's about the alignment with the convictions and the tradition and the space, the anchor that held us as a people. I'm not talking about the anchor that was delivered to us. I'm talking about the anchor that held us, the commitment that we had to each other. That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. I feel through the lens of the traditional Bahamas, the idea that existed in this particular space that continues to be able to speak about that Bahamian people are resilient, that we came from absolutely nothing, that we stood for something and we move forward. There needs to be solitude. There needs to be a commitment. There needs to be this sort of an idea that I'm committed to the foundation of who we are as a people. And not to the froth that exists at the surface, you know. Because after one bubble goes, another bubble comes, and it just is one bubble after another. But that steady approach and the pertinence, the pulp, exists within the body. And I don't feel like our politicians are aligned with the body of who we are as a people. I can say the exact same thing about the church. I don't think that the church is aligned with the body of Christ. At least as you do for these, you do for me. Let's just be very clear about this. There is a significant disconnect in this country. The disconnect exists between the people and the politicians. The body, the electorate, let's call it that. The community, the grassroots, as the PLP would say. And those who ascend to leadership positions in this country. It's absolutely bananas. I just want to say it like this to you. I have to. For me to be able to see my prime minister sitting with the Pope, I mean, for all of you who are Catholic, don't fight me. It's not about the denomination that he's sitting with. It really doesn't matter. For me, the Pope represents the leadership of an entire country, a movement of people. And I'll take the exact same umbrage and position and posture if our prime minister was sitting with anybody from Sudan. It doesn't make a difference. This time in the country should have been dedicated to the commitment, an idea of being able to reflect. I took time out. We did everything we could to be as decent as possible before Obadiah Wojcicki was placed in the ground. Friday, we dedicated an entire show. And everyone knows I don't agree with his politics. He knows that. He knew that. It doesn't take away from the fact that his commitment to people was strong. And this is why I said the other day that I knew that Hubert Ingraham wouldn't put any, because their commitment, they're closer to the traditional core of who we are as Bahamians. And so there was no expectation that anything could go awry or that they would do anything contrary. We talked about this. Politicians seem to be pursuing their own agendas. And I think heading that pact is our prime minister. And I say this with the greatest degree of respect. And I continue to be able to acknowledge the prime minister's position and strength. This is not me trying to be condescending. I'm simply saying to you that if I were to be reading the cards, and making a determination how I would play my next card to be able to identify and strengthen my position against the next player, which is the prime minister, I have to assume that he's not even in this game, that he has all aces and he's not even in this game. Let's just talk about this. The prime minister sought and found it absolutely necessary to continue, remain committed to the idea of being able to go elsewhere. In the midst of a national crisis, we've lost a cabinet minister. Yeah, it's almost like autopilot. Everything is taking care of itself. Then we saw pictures of the prime minister feeding the poor. This is a lot. This is a lot. One thing I got to say, I give the PLP A for effort, but I got to give you a D minus for empathy. D minus. Even what I'm seeing happening in West Grand Bahama with Shane Gibson and the fight that exists between, what an obvious fight between the chairman and the potential candidate. Let's just be very clear about this. D minus for empathy. D minus. You cannot say on one side of your mouth, the great man that Obi was, the inability to be able to fill his shoes, to do all these things, and then you take on the position, let me wear his shirt and rally in the streets. This is bananas. There has to be a solemn approach to do this. People are going to vote for you, despite. Those PLPs are going to vote for you, despite. You don't have to get them riled up and in the streets. You know, I mean, this is bananas to me. This is bananas. And then I'm watching so many persons take on, I don't know, this election fever. This must be spring fever. It's too much. I'm watching so many people take on this position now to say that I'm the man for West Grand Bahama and Bimini. You wasn't with me shooting in the gym. You wasn't with us shooting in the crate. You wasn't. Hey, listen, if West Grand Bahamian people vote for you, you know, kudos to you. It only speaks to the desperation that exists in this community, which is a microcosm of the desperation that exists in the country. West Grand Bahama people don't even look at you if you ain't born in West Grand Bahama or Bimini. They don't even look at you. Central Grand Bahama have a way of being able to look at their candidates. Look at who the PLP used to put in there. Look at who the FNM put in there. Look. You have to know these things, man. And if you're going to take on this position and be naive about this and supersede and reject the concept and idea that exists in this space, then you get what you deserve. I mean, the people and the politicians. No one has presented a plan for the people. No one. No one. No one. No one came out with a concept and idea to say that we can do this. This is a plan for the direction of what needs to happen in West Grand Bahama and Bimini. And, you know, the politicians that you've identified, the only thing they can do is be able to talk to the tangibility of what they're going to be able to put in the community. The intangibles is why the community is broken. But you don't know that because you're not from there. The intangibles is why the community is broken in West Grand Bahama and Bimini. The fact of the matter is that just like being in Grand Town, just like Kemp Road, just like Pinewood, just like Gambier, and any other impoverished, broken constituency in our country, they lack hope and leadership, whether the head, the body, or the tail, leadership has not presented a vision that they're committed to being able to see reformation in those communities. I'm so happy that you're feeding the kids. I am. But they've been hungry. And we are going to count down the days and sense of consistency that you have with this feeding program. It's a pilot program now. I commend you on taking those steps. But your lack of empathy only puts you in a campaign mode in your mind, not even understanding how can we ensure that there's sustainability for this program, that this program will actually last far beyond our tenure if we just step out, because our responsibility beyond getting back in office is to ensure that we take care of the people that gave us this opportunity. I got to talk like this, man. No one's talking to me about West Grand Bahama. No one. All you're saying is, I'm the man. Well, Schaff is the man. Schaff is the man. Why don't we put him in the constituency? Let's talk about this. You are wilding out. Your commitment, lackluster. Your focus, distorted. Your words, few and far between. Your actions, horrid, deplorable from a political standpoint. And your social consciousness, your ability to kind of touch and understand exactly where we are, is not even evident. I wish you guys all the absolute best, but we need reform in this country. We need change. And there's no need for us to spill into one conspiracy theory or another. It is quite obvious. There is an agenda that's bigger than the people of the Bahamas. There is an agenda that strategically puts politicians in a position so they can be able to sustain themselves and their families. And there is a relentless rejection of the people who placed you in this space, in this seat. I respect you guys, but I'm looking for reciprocity. I'm looking for this give and take. I'm looking for when I give you respect, that I get it in return. And I'm not feeling you guys. I'm not with the campaign jive. I'm not with the hooting and hollering. I'm just not. I'm about measured concepts, ideas, identifying talent, taking an assessment of the environment, getting the data, making a determination as to where to place our resources for growth and development, understanding where the community has been tripped over, being able to place the proper resources and identifying those persons who can be able to speak the language of restitution, of reformation, of rejuvenation, of this sort of an idea, not restitution. I mean, I just want to be very clear with you. I want to be very clear with you. I want to be very clear with you. I do not feel you. I do not. And, it's neither here nor there that I say this and take on this kind of a position. It's neither here nor there. But the fact of the matter is that you know, and I know, that your commitment is lackluster. That your pontification and capability to be able to rally people up with a couple dollars, a couple drinks, some loud music, and those frequency and rhythms that continue to be able to move those African beats that move black people. That's what you're doing. That's all you're doing. But after the silence creeps in the dead of the night, and the only thing that you have in your home and in your space is the ability to look within yourself, introspection, then you got to ask yourself the question, what am I doing? It's just unfortunate that when the sun rises, you do the thing all over again. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you so very kindly for tuning in with us today. I want to be able to say, your boy is going to be traveling. So I thank all you guys for being able to send their well wishes and whatnot. We're going to be here live and in full effect. We have some great things set up for you. Tomorrow, I may have to play a rerun. We're going to look for a good one. Someone send some suggestions. What would you like to hear again? 8270111. Have a beautiful day. Enjoy yourself. And move with sobriety. Don't allow these politicians, these sycophants, don't allow these people who are desperate and eager to show their political organization buoyant and always on top. Don't allow them to destroy our country. We need to find vision, consistency, strength, and the type of relationships that feed people, not an agenda. Let's make this thing happen. 96.9 FM radio, Howard Grant in your company, the foundation on this absolutely gorgeous Monday afternoon. Guys, have a beautiful day. Stick and stay for Chivago with Z Live right after this. We'll be right back.
That's a sex machine to all the chicks. You're damn right.